Why we do the things we do. Human beings are amazing. They have the ability to think, feel, reason, decide, change their minds, and accomplish extraordinary things. Unique among all creatures on Earth, individuals have the ability to determine the course and direction of their own destinies, and to change their futures. They can continually write and rewrite the scripts of their own lives. All things are possible for them. Your amazing brain has 10 billion neurons, each of which is connected to as many as 20,000 others. This means that the total number of mental connections or thoughts that you can think is 10 million to the 20,000th power, a number that is greater than all the molecules in the known universe. You have the ability to process enormous amounts of information, to learn huge quantities of facts and data, and to apply your mind to achieving health, happiness, harmony, prosperity, and a wonderful life for yourself and your family. Your true potential is only limited by your imagination and by your willingness and ability to be, do, and have all the things that you can imagine for yourself. And since there are no limitations on what you can imagine, there are really no limitations on what you can do with your life, except those limitations that you impose on yourself. You have the ability to set goals, make plans, learn almost any subject you need to learn, manage your time, communicate and negotiate with others, overcome obstacles, and win through to your own personal victories. If you live in the United States, you are surrounded by unlimited opportunities, protected by the best legal system in the world, guaranteed of personal liberty and individual rights. You are living in the most affluent time in all of human history, and in the richest and most powerful country of all time. Now, with all these advantages and blessings available to you and to others, why is it that so few people realize their full potentials? Why is it that so many people, by their own admissions, are leading lives of quiet desperation? Almost everything you are or ever will be can be traced back to human nature and the elements of human nature that predominate in the things you think, say, and do. Human nature can be a blessing or a curse, depending upon what parts of it you embrace and encourage, and what parts of it you downplay and disregard. There is both a bright side and a dark side of your nature, an angel and a devil. These two forces compete continually in your mind and heart for control of your thoughts, feelings, and actions. Fortunately, these elements are not fixed, but flexible. You are always free to choose. The only thing in the world over which you have complete control is your thinking. Only you can choose and decide what thoughts to think and to dwell upon. Your entire life today, in every respect, is the sum total of the choices and decisions that you have made up until now. Since only you can make the choices and decisions affecting your life, you are completely responsible for everything you are and everything you become. There are many characteristics and qualities that comprise what we call human nature. These are fundamental, inborn, hardwired, unchanging instincts possessed by all human beings going back into at least 6,000 years of recorded history. The starting point of recreating an unlimited future for yourself is for you to understand who you are and how you got to where you are today. Once you know these factors, you can move forward with greater confidence to create the future you desire. Sometimes I will start a business or sales seminar by conducting a brief quiz. I ask the audience if they would like to learn 4 years of university economics in 4 minutes. Almost everyone smiles and nods and agrees. I then begin by asking a series of questions. The first question is, if I could offer you a choice of jobs, both of which pay the same, but one is easy and the other is difficult, which one would you choose? When I ask for a show of hands, almost everyone raises their hand and chooses the easy job over the hard job. That's a good choice, I say. It's normal and natural for you to choose an easier job over a harder job. In fact, it is almost impossible for a normal person to choose a harder way to accomplish a result when an easier way is available. The most precious of all human commodities is life itself. Life is made up of the minutes, hours, and days of your existence. Life also consists of the amount of energy that you have to expend. Because you think economically, as all people do, you naturally strive to conserve the amount of time and energy you need to give in exchange for any element of your life. The more time and energy you save in accomplishing one task, the more time and energy you have available to accomplish other tasks and achieve other goals. In other words, by choosing the easier route, you are actually increasing the amount of life that you have available for other things. The result of this instinctive way of acting is that you are lazy. Everyone is lazy. It is a normal, natural human instinct. It is both healthy and helpful. It is the way that you conserve energy. Laziness in itself is neither good nor bad. It is only in the way that laziness is demonstrated that causes it to be defined as positive or negative. For example, if laziness is demonstrated by finding faster, better, cheaper, easier ways to accomplish tasks and achieve goals, which is the motive force behind all advancement in human civilization, then laziness is a good thing. It is beneficial. It's helpful. Laziness is the force that has driven all improvements in technology, manufacturing, production, agriculture, transportation, medicine, education, and every other field of human advancement. The natural tendency toward laziness and toward reducing the amount of time and effort needed to accomplish a result is a major contributor to the quality of life that is possible for you in the 21st century. However, laziness also has a dark side. If people's natural laziness causes them to slack off, cut corners, avoid work, fail to complete tasks, waste time, start later and leave earlier, and generally contribute less to their jobs and families, then laziness is bad. Laziness is bad in this sense because it robs the potential of the individual who practices it. It diminishes his possibilities in the present and undermines his hopes for the future. Laziness expressed in a negative way will usually ruin a person's prospects for success and advancement. But laziness in and of itself is neutral. It is neither good nor bad. It is only in the way that laziness is expressed that allows one to make a positive or negative judgment about it. The economics lesson continues. I then go on and ask the next question. Imagine that I could offer you two different salaries for performing the same job. $10,000 per year or $100,000 per year? Which one would you choose? By a show of hands, everyone chooses the higher amount over the lower amount. Even if the difference was between a job paying $95,000 per year and $100,000 per year, if it were the same job, everyone would choose the higher amount. Again, this is normal and natural. It is mentally impossible for a person to choose less when he could have more, all things considered. The desire for more is instinctive and hardwired into the human brain. Even infants and children in every culture, when given the choice between more or less, for example, in the case of candy or dessert, will always choose more. No education or training is necessary. I then go on to explain, what this means is that everyone here is basically greedy. Every normal person prefers more to less throughout their lives in virtually every situation. Just as with laziness, greed is neither good nor bad. It is only in the way that a person manifests their natural instinctive greed that makes the action or behavior positive or negative. The desire for more was the motivating force behind the work of Mother Teresa of Calcutta and her missionaries of charity. They constantly wanted to help more people. Dr. Albert Schweitzer of Africa was greedy in the same way. Throughout his life, he constantly sought more resources so that he could help even more African natives as a medical missionary. If a person who wants to get more of the good things in life for himself and his family works longer hours, continually upgrades his skills, and continually offers to serve his customers with more of the things they want, this greed is positive and healthy. It leads to success, achievement, esteem, and respect in the community. It enables the individual and his family to enjoy a higher standard of living and a more exciting future. In this case, greed is good. The dark side of greed is what most people are familiar with. When people strive to get rewards without working, riches without contribution, recognition without achievement, power without service, they are manifesting the dark side of greed. Whenever someone attempts to get something for nothing in any area, they are manifesting the kind of greed that is harmful to the victim and ultimately destructive to the practitioner. When the entrepreneurial and creative energies of people motivated by greed are directed and channeled into productive activities, greed becomes a powerful and positive social good. It drives people to innovate and create newer, better, faster, and cheaper ways to provide products and services for others. Many politicians, demagogues, religious leaders, and well-meaning do-gooders are completely ignorant of the natural, normal, instinctive nature of greed. They attack those who strive to get more, especially business people who strive for more sales, more growth, and more profits, as inherently evil. By demonizing the normal and natural activities of people in business, they strive to create support for taxes to take away the money these people have earned and give it to others who have done nothing to earn these amounts. Whenever someone accuses someone else of being greedy, you can be sure of one thing. The person using the word in attacking another is either ignorant or dishonest or both or greedy himself. Accusing someone else of greed is the first step toward using the law to expropriate that person's money, and usually to use it in the best interest of the person advocating the theft in the first place. We continue with the economics lesson. If I could offer you a job where you would have wonderful opportunities for growth and advancement, or I could offer you a dead-end job with limited opportunities or job security, which would you choose? Again, everyone chooses the job with opportunities for promotion and advancement. Once again, this is normal and natural. All human action is aimed at an improvement in conditions of some kind. Everyone prefers to be better off rather than worse off. Everyone hopes for a better future rather than a worse future. You always have a choice. You can either act or not act. You can either do something or do nothing. The only reason that you will take action is because you anticipate being better off as a result. This is the foundation principle that explains virtually all human and economic activity. If you're confronted with a choice of two actions, you will always choose the action that you feel will leave you better off than the other. Whether or not you are correct in your choice, you will always choose more improvement over less improvement. But you will only act if you expect to improve your situation in some way. What this means is that everyone is ambitious. Everyone wants to be better off. Everyone wants to improve their situation. It is only in the way ambition is manifested that makes it either positive or negative. If your ambition drives you to become a better person, do a better job, work harder, stay later, and contribute more, then ambition is a good thing. It serves your life. It guarantees your present and opens doors to your future. The more ambitious you are in a positive and constructive way, the more you will accomplish for yourself and your family. The more ambitious you are, the better life you can create for yourself. All successful people are ambitious in some way. In the past 25 years, I've given more than 3,000 talks and seminars and spoken to almost 3 million people in 42 countries. In questionnaires and surveys, I've sought for the common denominator of people who seek to improve themselves throughout their lives. I finally concluded that there is only one word to describe successful people, and the word is hungry. Successful people are hungry. They have an intense desire to be more, do more, and have more than they've ever had before. They want to improve their lives, and they recognize that your life only gets better when you get better. They are ambitious in a healthy, helpful way. On the other hand, if a person's ambition leads him to engage in behaviors that are harmful to others by lying, cheating, deceiving, defrauding, or taking advantage of people, this form of ambition is negative and destructive. Now, there are two ways that people manifest ambition in our society. The first is by serving and helping other people. The second is by using and abusing people for short-term personal benefit. The first is a positive manifestation of ambition, and the second is a negative manifestation. But ambition itself is a neutral word. It is neither good nor bad in itself. The fourth question I ask to round off this economics lesson is, now that you have chosen the easier job, paying $100,000 per year, with opportunities for growth and advancement, if I could give you that amount in full on January 1 of the year or December 31st of that year, which date would you choose? Again, everyone would choose to have the money on January 1 rather than December 31. This is normal and natural as well. Human beings prefer earlier to later in the satisfaction of any need or desire. One of the many reasons for this is obvious. It is the old saying, better a bird in the hand than two in the bush. The earlier you receive it, the less risk there is that you will get it at all. Not only that, but you will be able to spend it sooner. In almost every case, people prefer earlier to later. People do not like or want to wait. They want what they want right now. We say that in our fast-moving society, instant gratification is no longer fast enough. People who did not know that they wanted something until this minute now want it immediately, if not sooner. In other words, everyone is impatient. Everyone is in a hurry. Look at how insistent children are in demanding that they be given what they want immediately, and adults are just children with better excuses. The quality of impatience is neither good nor bad. It is simply a hardwired category of human nature. If the desire to get things quickly motivates a person to create innovative products and services that satisfy customers faster, impatience is a good thing. If people work harder and faster to accomplish the same result so that they can get more of the things that they want, impatience is beneficial and advantageous. On the other hand, the dark side of impatience is when people cut corners, compromise quality, and step over or upon other people to get the things they want faster than they are entitled to. When a person's impatience for rewards drives him to engage in illegal or harmful behaviors that hurt himself or others, then impatience is a negative manifestation of human nature. Impatience can be good. The driving force of technological advancement for hundreds of years has been the desire to produce products and services, achieve goals, and get results faster than before. The primary advantage that one technology has over another today is that the user can get a result faster with it than he could with a competing technology. At this point, I summarize the economics lesson with the following conclusion. We have now learned about the first four instinctive drives of human nature. What we know is that everyone is lazy, greedy, ambitious, and impatient. This applies to every person, everywhere, in all circumstances. These qualities are neither good nor bad in themselves. They are neutral. The qualities of laziness, greed, ambition, and impatience apply to saints and sinners, consumers and producers, salespeople and customers, businesses and markets, politicians and bureaucrats, young and old, rich and poor, uneducated and educated. This is the way the world works. The smartest thing that you can do in your interactions is to anticipate and expect that people will always be lazy, greedy, ambitious, and impatient in getting the things they want. Now, many people are shocked and angry by this sweeping description of human nature. They vehemently deny that this is a description of themselves. They are reluctant to accept that others behave this way. But this description of the way people think and act is not an opinion. It is a fact. It is an honest and clear description of the basic driving forces of human nature. There are certain laws of nature, like gravity, that we have to take into consideration in everything we do. The law of gravity is not a personal opinion. It does not function depending upon whether or not you know about it, or whether or not you believe in it. Gravity works all the time, everywhere, for everyone, under all conditions, without exceptions. The laws of human nature are the same. We do not try to change the unchangeable. We may attempt to modify them in ourselves and others, to direct them into positive channels, but what intelligent people do is to accept these inevitable and unavoidable characteristics and behaviors and take them into consideration in everything that they and others do and say. In addition to these four instinctive drives, there are three more basic instincts that are hardwired into the human psyche. They are also essential to understanding human nature and individual behavior. The next, number five, has to do with happiness. Aristotle wrote that the pursuit of happiness is the ultimate aim of all human activity. Everything you do is an attempt to achieve your own happiness, or even more happiness than you already have. In 1895, Sigmund Freud described this as the pleasure principle. This idea subsequently became the basis of modern psychology. He said that every human action is an attempt to avoid pain and seek pleasure. You are continually attempting to move from discomfort to comfort. You continually seek ways to be better off rather than worse off. You continually strive to be happy. Here's the challenge. No one can decide for anyone else what will make him or her happy. Only you can decide for yourself. Only you can select the particular mixture and combination of ingredients that gives you pleasure at this particular time. You are unique, special, and different in all the history of the world. There never has been and never will be anyone exactly like you. There will never be anyone with your particular combination of tastes, desires, feelings, habits, experiences, likes, dislikes, hopes, and fears. What makes you the happiest will be different from that of any other person you ever meet. Because you are such a complex person with so many dimensions to your personality, the exact combination of ingredients that will make you happy changes continually, from day to day, hour to hour, and even from minute to minute. Happiness is a moving target. It is never fixed or final, and only you can decide, because only you can feel inside when you are truly happy. The basic premise of communism in the 20th century, which led to the deaths of more than 100 million people in wars, revolutions, executions, and famines, was that human nature could be changed. Those who espoused communism, and especially communist leaders, were convinced that they could decide for others the precise ingredients of happiness that was best for the people they ruled. They acted on the premise that human nature was malleable, like soft clay, and that man could be shaped, forcefully if necessary, into a new type of person. This person would be transformed into their idea of what they thought people should be, without their normal and natural human wants, needs, desires, fears, and compulsions. Communism has now almost completely disappeared, totally discredited by those forced to live under it. Unfortunately, there are still people in Western society with this totalitarian temptation, primarily academics and politicians, who feel that they are somehow capable of deciding for others what is best for them. They feel that most people are not capable of choosing the correct combination of ingredients that will make them happy. They simultaneously conclude that they, being superior somehow in intelligence and vision, are capable of making these decisions for the masses. Every attempt to move in this direction is ultimately destined for failure, because you cannot change human nature. Now, everything that you do is aimed at achieving your own personal happiness, even if, in the process of achieving your own happiness, you sacrifice greatly for others, your family or your fellow man. Everything you do is still inherently selfish. Only you can decide for yourself. No one else can think for you, feel for you, taste for you, experience for you, or decide for you. Everything you do is selfish in that you do it from the perspective of what gives you pleasure or pain, comfort or discomfort, satisfaction or dissatisfaction. You are selfish in that you are a unique, self-centered human being, capable of making your own decisions and choices. No one can decide for you what is best for you except yourself. The quality of selfishness is neither good nor bad. It is simply a fact of human nature. Rational selfishness is what you practice when you engage in behaviors that are good for you and not harmful to anyone else. If your selfishness drives you to engage in socially productive and helpful activities so that you can get more of the things that make you happy, then your selfishness is a positive benefit to society. On the other hand, if your selfishness is short-sighted and indifferent to the well-being of others, you may engage in behaviors that give you pleasure or satisfaction in the short term, but which lead to even greater unhappiness and dissatisfaction in the long term, both for yourself and for others. But selfishness itself is neither positive nor negative. It is only the way that you express your selfishness that makes it either good or bad. The sixth quality of human nature has to do with the fact that every person has an ego. The word ego from the Latin means I am. Your self-concept, the way you think and feel about yourself, is the master program of your subconscious computer. Everything you do on the outside is guided and determined by the way you think and feel about yourself on the inside. The most important part of your self-concept is your self-esteem. This is defined as how much you like yourself. Almost everything you do is aimed at either increasing your self-esteem or protecting it from being diminished by other people and circumstances. Human beings strive towards self-esteem, self-respect, and personal happiness all their lives. The second part of your self-concept is your self-image. This is made up of three elements: the way you see yourself, the way that you think others see you, and the way that you would like to be seen by others. Almost everything you do in your interactions with other people is guided by your self-image. You constantly strive to improve your self-image, and especially the way that others see you, in everything you do that involves other people. Your feelings of self-esteem and self-worth are closely linked to how well your self-image is supported by the way that others treat you. The greater the level of respect and esteem that you receive from others, the better you feel about yourself, the more you like yourself, and the happier you are. What this means is that you are vain. You are concerned about the way you look and appear to others. You are concerned about what people say and think about you. You're concerned about earning and keeping the esteem and respect of the important people in your world. It's been said that everything you do is to earn the respect of people who you respect, or at least not to lose their respect. Vanity is neither good nor bad. It is simply a fact of life. It is a normal and natural part of your human nature. It is the driving force behind all of the industries that produce clothing, fashion, cosmetics, jewelry, perfume, and every other factor that contributes to the way you appear on the outside or how others think about you. Vanity drives people to achieve material success so that they can drive bigger cars, live in better homes, go to nicer restaurants, and generally be respected and esteemed more by people in their social circle and community. A positive element of vanity is when you set high standards for yourself, for your manners and behavior, for your dress and appearance, for your communications and interactions with others. The most respected people in any social grouping are those people who are considerate and sensitive to the wants, needs, and opinions of others. They engage in positive, productive behaviors. In the society pages of any newspaper, you will see photographs of people in evening dress attending charity functions in support of good causes in the community. People pay enormous amounts of money and donate significant amounts of time in order to be seen in the company of other highly respected people in their social circles. In this sense, vanity is a good thing. It leads to a higher quality of life throughout society. Well, there's a dark side to vanity as well. If a person's vanity and desire for ego satisfaction causes him to behave in negative or harmful ways to himself and others, then vanity becomes a negative quality. Many people manifest their natural vanity in hurtful behaviors, such as arrogance, conceit, rudeness, disrespect, and impatience with others.